sixth Catholic lecture, and we have the pleasure to receive Athina Papadopoulos, who is a Canadian-born artist based in London for the last 6 years, and she has been with us all day today in honor of her painting, so she'll be presenting her work today to everyone. So thank you very much for coming, and we'll have Q&A after, if that's okay. Thank you.
Deliver a baby And when I was procrastinating, I looked at shark attack videos and read news stories about a curious coincidence of three women joggers getting murdered during daytime runs, all unconnected around the same time, all splayed out, raped and left in forests. And it made me think of that Duchamp piece. In Teas of Ease, these sculptures, these things, fabrics or other garments take on the life of their own. The idea that those clothing articles have narrative potential and become sculptural or rather figures in their own right, containing or holding invisible ghostly bodies. But let's go back to the pre-haunting, the brutalized, downtrodden woman depicted or represented in historical literature and pop culture. Woman as clothing accessory, how certain archetypes of men, the geriatric Lothario, the figure of the father, Tony Soprano, Berlusconi guy, uses or surrounds himself with rather dresses himself with women to be perceived as virile, powerful, or just women as supporting characters. Support. Ivanka Trump says at the end of the first Wives Club, don't get mad, get everything. So I like to think of my work and myself as a three-pronged fork, not the preferred and more practical and useful four-pronged fork. I like threes. So let's talk about my art. So the first prong is, well, my art related to this like fork allegory. So the first prong is materials. The second prong is process. The third prong is subject matter. Well, I guess you could say everyone's practice could be described as a fork. The food is the art, the fork holds the food. The art is penetrated, is skewered by these three stakes. Simple enough idea. Not so fast. Let's talk about that again. So I like to think about my work as myself really as a three-pronged fork, not the preferred four-pronged fork. I like threes. Let's talk about my art though. So the first prong is materials, the second prong is process, and the third prong is subject matter. Well, I guess you could say everyone's practice could be described in the same way, described as a fork. The food is the art, the fork holds the food. The art is penetrated, is skewered by the three stakes. Simple enough idea, not so fast. Let's talk about that again. All right, well, I think that's right, materials. Now let's talk about materials. Dolling yourself up, crimping and pimping yourself out. So I think that covers subject matter. The second prong is the middle child, and I'm the middle child, so process, the thing that always gets me in trouble. Where's that subject matter? I like the idea of positive contamination, infecting the work with multiple viruses, multiple diseases, abusing them, then treating them in a tantric sort of way, whipping them, spitting on them, degrading them, cabling them. Okay, so that covers process. Now for the hot topic of subject matter. subject matter, but we've gone over this. I've talked it to death. I've said it too many times. And you don't want to hear it again. Miss Piggy, Slam Pig, Butterface, You Skirts, Hens, Chicks, Birds. Oh, or as Danny DeVito's character says in LA Confidential, screwing this gorgeous slut. Voice control. You know voice control? Did you know it's made out of pig's hormones? Well, if you feel fucked up about that idea, imagine me discovering that after taking it for 29 years. So am I a pig now too? Well, when I was a girl, I wanted to be a plastic surgeon. Don't ask me why. But before that, I was fixated on figures like Zsa Zsa Gabor, who made a career out of marrying wealthy men. I thought I could do that. Well, that worked out. Can't even get married. How the hell am I supposed to get divorced? Oh shit. Almost done. My work is a fucked up love letter from yours truly. Check. I want to twist things, turn things, and knock them into each other. Now slide up on my lap. I found that, well, every other time except this time, in the past experiences or often when I do presentations, well, I go on and on for a really long time. And then when I pause, someone interjects or something like, I think that's good. I think we've probably heard enough. I think you could stop there. But I could have not stopped there and filled the time a little bit more, but somehow, I don't know, it just felt a lot longer when I was reading it in my head. So that's it. Thank you. Very long amount of time to spend together. Ask me anything.
Do we have any questions for Athena?
Should I do it again? If you want, I can kind of go through the slides again if you want to look a little bit at.
There's a question. Sorry, what is a bull whistle?
It's kind of like, have you ever seen that? It's like a, like, it comes from this kind of, I think like 40s or 30s cartoon of a wolf, like maybe Disney or something, where there's like this wolf kind of, it's an old term for like when a woman walks by and men are like, you know, it's kind of like, it's sort of like a cat call, but kind of more old school, where like it's not so derogatory, but it can also be like just trying to get someone's attention. But then cat calls have a different kind of connotation. They're more derogatory and kind of objectifying. And then also like just the term cat calls, like that's what I was kind of saying, like where it's like slam pig or this thing. Like I'm kind of interested in this like idea of how women are like being transformed into like through terminologies like animals. like kind of derogatory terms that turn them into animals, but like at the same time there's a history of women as animals in a sort of kind of powerful way through like mythology and that kind of thing. So like half woman, half animal. So it can kind of go either way, but I guess that's something that I like kind of like it's a sort of associative process that I kind of go through with like these terminologies and then turn them into new, more powerful hybrids that, you know, when you think of that word like slam pig, well, like now slam pig is something different in a way. Like, it's this kind of form. It's no longer that kind of definition. It's got a new visual definition, which is like my work.
Could you maybe talk a bit more about punk in relation
to work? You mentioned punk. Well, actually, I was talking to a student today about this idea of punk and how it's like really hard to be like actually punk now because it's like been appropriated by kind of capitalist strategies to like remarket it back as like cool. So yeah, no one can be a punk anymore really, but I think there are like strategies around not kind of buying into that, that's and working on the periphery that can kind of be, I don't know, like you can, yeah, I don't have an answer to that. I'm interested in the way it kind of developed and like the histories of it and the kind of like lower, like New York in the 1980s, like the Lower East Side kind of figures that were using like appropriation and like a figure like Kathy Acker, which now like she's, you know, everyone's like super into her, but like she was kind of taking like Jean Genet and Burroughs and like kind of using their form, like stealing their form, but also like inserting her own personal narrative into her writing. And in a way that's sort of like a bit of like, I mean, and she didn't really even consider herself like a hardcore feminist in any sense. She was just like, I can kind of do that too, and I'm gonna steal from these like kind of monolithic kind of figures, but also reinsert the personal back into that. And like, of course, Chris Krauss is kind of was a younger part of a sort of younger generation, but she was kind of around the time of a lot of her writing uses similar strategies. So that's something I'm also really like, how could you do that with art in a visual way as well?
Do you think it can still exist within sort of like static form?
Well, like for instance, like Vivian Westwood, she's the way that she kind of collaged and appropriated and used fashion was sort of punk because it was like, I think punk is kind of like appropriation and assemblage in a sense. It's like I was talking about the dominatrix who takes from the saint, like the saint who's like punishing herself because she doesn't want to feel like desirous kind of impulses. So she like whips herself, she flagellates, she wears like these bras that have like studs on the inside in order to like rid herself of any feeling of pleasure. And then you have someone like the figure of the dominatrix who kind of appropriates those kind of practices and like administers them as pleasure, you know? So it's like kind of, so that's what I mean, like the dominatrix is sort of punk because she like blasphemizes those practices. And that's how I imagine, like, it's like making the holy, like, or the sanctified profane, you know? It's like carnivalesque in that sense, which I was talking to one of the students about today. So that's my kind of idea, but of course there's like books and sartorial kind of like coffee table books that kind of like, you know, track the history of like punk through fashion, but I think, you know, you can look at it through literature and also through like kind of historical means and associative means of like thinking about different figures. But I'm no expert.
I ask you about process and materials, like in a way, like an extension from that, because like with your sculptures, there's so many different things which you seem to use to sort of make them, and then they have certain kind of associations and references. And it seems like you have a sort of, it's like you have an idea of what you want the work to be, it sounds like, but then it's also utilizing these elements within it. So do they come first or second? So like in the show you had at Emmeline, there was so many elements
right.
that went into each sculpture.
Yeah, so the way that like I got there was just through a series of making different works. So like I did one series that used like this material, like I started with just like trying to find substitutes for paint that had to do with a particular kind of connotation, like things that people use to like stain the insides, outsides of their skin, body, predominantly things that are used by women to like transform themselves. And so I thought like, well, why not kind of build things with stuff that like humans would use if you're kind of interested in like building like these kind of figures that are like hybrids of all of these different like ideas and histories and personal histories. And, but these are the most kind of like, you know, they have the most kind of material in them than any other work that I've done in the past, but it's just kind of like an accumulation of different processes that I kind of pick up along each time I finish a body of work. I'm like thinking about the next one, and I know that I can use that because I used that in the last one, but maybe I'll want to add something new in, and like, so it's like a slow building process, but it's kind of like quite dynamic because each time I think of a different thing, but it's familiar because like I've used those materials before, but I'm just like moving them in different, putting them in different places. So it's all sort of, for me, it feels like the same thing, but just in a different economy, basically.
Can you go back to the slide when someone's riding a bull?
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk about that?
Well, I was like just in.
Or it's not a bull. Oh yeah, it is.
It's like I like it because I just found it online because I didn't want to be too gratuitous with showing you images of my work. You know, there's other things out there in the world. But I was just like in Vegas and I saw like all these different bars, and there was like these like bull ladies on bulls, and they were just like going so crazy, and I've never seen anything like that before, and I just thought like, wow, I like just love that. Also, like I saw these mice in a window of a store. And why is it blue? Also, like his trousers, they're like Marquis Almeida, or however the hell you say that designer's name. You know, wanted those for a while, but they're just a little too expensive. But he has them, so. but the other guy's jacket I probably wouldn't wear. These are the Smurfette sculptures. So also like the Smurfettes, the terminology. Like so I'm also looking at like Urban Dictionary terms. So it's really hard to find like new words on Urban Dictionary. Like if you start looking for them, you're like, I just can't find anything, you know. So they have to be like words of the week in order to sometimes find these words, or you have to have heard them before and then look them up. So it's like it's not such a user-friendly site. Or maybe I just am really bad at using it, but like I'm looking for like more of these like slang terms. So, actually already knew that term. It's like a girl, you know, the Smurfs. It's like, there's only pretty much one girl Smurf. And so, but there's like a whole colony, so obviously she's sort of like, it's the reference that she's like the kind of village bicycle. And like when I grew up, I was like the only girl in a group of like all guys who were all my friends, and I slept with all of them. So like that really, you know, that kind of term really was like super important to me, because it was like, that's kind of like what I was. So I thought, you know, why not make these kind of like baby Smurfettes? Like I was a baby Smurfette, but like I'm not a Smurfette anymore. I've like been in like so many monogamous relationships like over the past, I don't know, 15 years. Like I can't even like begin to describe like how long I haven't been single for. So I just thought like, well, what if I like kind of grew in, like what if that baby Smurf became like a big like Smurfette woman, and like how would she, you know, she'd be so confident and so like cool. So yeah. But like there's different, I don't know. There's different like letters like made out of resin hanging off of them that are like these kind of oversized kind of charms and trinkets that I like hand make, well, hand pour, like and ingest all the chemicals of the polyester resin into my skin and hair and lungs. They kind of spell out words. So this one says like battered, and then another one will say like bruised, one will say like chewed up, and another will say like spit out. So they're kind of like words that kind of connote like kind of abuse, but then at the same time they kind of like work in a way that is like describes the way that the sculptures are processed. So like you know, they're kind of quite literally battered in this kind of like gluey hair, self-tanner kind of concoction that I make, or they're like abused in the way that they're kind of put together. They're bruised, they fall over, they break, and then they're kind of like glued and assembled back together. Yeah.
Quite interesting, because it almost remind me of a shrine. I just wonder if there is somehow maybe a relation to a mythology or a kind of maybe religion that, I mean, not straightforward, but maybe, yeah, the relation to spirituality or...
I do like these kind of more 2D works that are a bit like painting, and people have said to me that they like remind them of shrines or kind of like a teenager's bedroom where they have, yeah, like all of the images. And I guess, I don't know, I kind of that was something that I used to do as a teenager, and I just like the kind of, like I don't do it in like that much of a conceptual way. I just think that it's a kind of like obsessive strategy of working, a way of working, so it's like, you're just kind of consumed within like building out this world, and sometimes you get really ahead of yourself and get kind of crazy in it, and it just becomes really, really like a labor, and then you remove and abuse and keep adding, but you just, it's just like building and building and building. And then, you know, the... Yeah.
Hi, you had some work, I think it was last year at Tate, Lab at Tate. It was like a backdrop to the music.
Yeah,
I mean, I was wondering if you thought that kind of changes the meaning or kind of what the function of the art then.
Well, that was like quite an experimental thing to do. Like, I don't normally do stuff like that, but kind of going back to this like shrine like kind of comment, like I kind of came of age in like Vancouver, which is like had this, I didn't really go to, or like in my undergrad I was in just university. I did like a bit of art courses, and I never went to any shows, any openings, like anything like that. I just went to like gigs and like friends, like bands shows. So there was just like tons. The only way I was like exposed to like making in a way that was outside of like a painting class was like through people's like merch and stuff. So like that's why I like kind of like use a lot of like t-shirt transfers for my like all the images I use. Like hand sewing things, it's like super DIY. Cause like that's literally like how I kind of experienced like making something outside of like being in an art class and making a painting. And so it just seemed like logical for me to like work in that more natural way. Like, cause no one asked anyone to do that. They just do it cause it's like amateur. And so then like I got offered to do this thing with Tate and like Young Lean, which I was like a bit like, ugh, you know? Am I that cool? And then it was kind of interesting because I thought like, well, you know, why not? And it will give me like a moment to like see what that's like. And I kind of like grew up being around that, so it wasn't super weird. But I probably wouldn't do it again, to be honest. And I made all of these dresses where I like, because I wanted to bring these women to life, so I actually used real women and I made these dresses where I took like bridesmaids dresses and I like cut them all up and like re-sewed them together and then like had them wearing these like sachets of like, you know, like desperation and like, you know, all of the kind of cliches of what bridesmaids are supposed to be. But then I have like made my drawings into tattoos and like tattooed all of them. I mean, yeah, it was kind of like exciting and fun, but really what I'm gonna do with those dresses is like turn them into like an element of like future sculptures. But I don't know, it was a cool thing to do. So I don't think it undermines the work and I don't think necessarily adds that much, but you know, it was fun and we made the dresses and now I'll use them in something else. Was there another question?
Mm-hmm. Have you found it difficult making work about, I feel like a lot of your work is about being a female,
mm-hmm.
or like a female, have you found it difficult making work about that, just in relation to like the male, like dominant art world or something like that?
Well first of all, I don't really feel like, and I'm not talking about like, oh I'm this gender, that gender, I don't really feel like I'm a woman really, I just like, I actually feel like I make work from the perspective of like a man looking at a woman in a sense, so it's a bit of a weird dynamic, but I mean, yeah, sure, there's like some issues still around it, but I like somehow don't feel like I haven't gotten, you know, opportunities and stuff like that, and I'm like often one of the only women included in like big groups of men, but as you know, I'm very comfortable with that from my upbringing, so. Yeah, but you know, they're not just women, they're like, they're kind of hybrids of a lot of different things, so that it can be kind of seen by like anybody and, Okay. Thank you so much.